Hello and welcome to video lecture series in sociology. Today we are going to discuss from your textbook Social Change and Development in India, chapter 2 titled as Cultural Changes. As you know, this chapter is divided into two parts. The first part deals with social reform movement and the second part discusses the processes of cultural change. In the previous lectures on this chapter, we have discussed about social reform movement in India and some processes of modernization and enlightenment. Today, we will discuss two other processes of cultural transformation. These are Sanskritization and Westernization. Unlike other processes of cultural change, they are specific to Indian context, particularly the process of Sanskritization. Let us understand what do we mean by Sanskritization. The term is coined by M.N. Srinivas. It is defined as a process by which a low caste or tribe or any other group takes over the customs, rituals, beliefs, ideology and style of life of a higher caste, particularly a twice born or a Dwij caste. To understand the concept of Sanskritization better, let us briefly discuss the caste system and its features. Caste is a form of stratification. The caste based stratification of the Indian society has its origin in the Chaturvarna system. What is Chaturvarna system? According to this doctrine, the Hindu society was divided into four varnas, namely Brahmins at the top, Kshatriyas, Vaishya and Shudras at the bottom. The varna system prevalent during the Vedic period was based upon division of labor and occupation. The caste system divides the society vertically. Every caste is further subdivided into subcastes, whose members follow a common occupation, social and ritual life, a common culture, and are governed by an authoritative body, which is the caste panchayat. Let us discuss the main features or attributes of the caste system. One of the important attribute or feature of caste system is that caste is based upon ascription, where both the status and occupation of an individual is determined by birth. Second, castes are graded and arranged into a hierarchy on the basis of their social superiority. Another important feature of caste is that choice of occupation is not free in caste system. Each caste or a group of allied caste is traditionally associated with a particular occupation. Castes are further divided into subcastes, and each subcaste is an endogamous group. What do we mean by endogamy? Endogamy is in fact the essence of caste system, which means that every caste or subcaste insists that its members should marry within the group. Each caste has its own traditional social status, occupations, customs, rules, regulations, and there is an unequal distribution of privileges and disabilities among its members. And finally, there is absence of vertical mobility in caste system. There is no mobility or movement of its members up or down the social status ladder. A person's status at birth is his lifetime status. It is in this context that the meaning of Sanskritization becomes important, as the process of Sanskritization is an endogenous source of social change. Sanskritization is a process of cultural change, whereby people of lower caste collectively try to adopt upper caste practices and beliefs to acquire a higher status. It indicates a process of cultural mobility that is taking place in the traditional social system of India. You can see the impact of Sanskritization on language, literature, ideology, music, dance, drama, rituals, styles of life. The Sanskritization of a group has usually the effect of improving its position in the local caste hierarchy. It entails either an improvement in the economic or political position of the group concerned, or a higher group self-consciousness, which comes from its contact with a source of great tradition of Hinduism, such as a pilgrimage center or a monastery, or a proselytizing sect. Through Sanskritization, people want to improve their status by adopting names and customs of culturally high placed groups. Apart from culture, the reference model is usually financially better off as well. In both, the aspiration or the desire to be like the higher placed group occurs only when people become wealthier or have resources to do so. It is also true that in modern societies, wealth offers chances of mobility and rise in social status, irrespective of one's caste status. However, the process of Sanskritization is not so simple and straight as defined. It is as complex as the caste system itself. Because the social acceptance of the group undergoing mobility or social mobility may not be so easy to come. In a highly stratified society such as India, there were and still are many obstacles to any easy taking over of the customs of the higher caste by the lower caste. In fact, you would be surprised to know that in traditional societies and still in some cases, the dominant caste punished such attempts made by the lower caste people. For a while, it would be interesting to see the presence of caste system in your everyday life. Have you ever heard your parents, family or friends talking about caste? If yes, in what context? Is it regarding marriage, occupation or any other spheres? Think of the eras where you have experienced dynamics of caste or what is your perception towards the caste system. Such questions will help you to see and assess the presence of caste in our everyday life. The concept of Sanskritization has also been criticized. Let's discuss some of these criticisms. The first is, Sanskritization is criticized for exaggerating social mobility or the scope of the lower caste to move up the social ladder. But this mobility has not led to any structural change or change in the caste system as such. It leads to only positional change of some groups or individuals. What does that mean? That means that caste-based inequality continues to persist, though some individuals may be able to improve their position within the asymmetrical social structure. Secondly, Sanskritization accepts caste-based social inequality as real, which means the ideology of Sanskritization accepts the position of upper caste as superior and the lower caste as inferior. Therefore, the desire to imitate the upper caste is seen as natural and desirable. And somewhere, it justifies the caste hierarchy. This leads to the third point of criticism, that Sanskritization justifies a model that rests on inequality and exclusion. It appears to suggest that to believe in pollution and purity of groups of people is justifiable or is all right. Therefore, to look down upon on some groups the way upper caste at times have been looking down upon the lower caste is a mark of privilege. Ironically, in society where such a worldview exists, imagining an equal society becomes difficult as caste has got deeply ingrained into our individual psyche. Caste-based discriminatory practices have become a way of life. Instead of aspiring for an equal society and questioning the structure of caste and its inherent problems, the exclusion and discrimination seeks to give a new meaning to excluded status. In a way, now, people aspire to be in a position from where they can in turn look down upon others and perpetuate caste inequality. Yet another point of criticism is that, since Sanskritization is adoption of upper caste rites and rituals, it also leads to practices of secluding women and girls, adopting dowry practices instead of paying bride price, and practicing caste discrimination against other low placed groups. This means that the discriminatory practices within the group are also adopted in the process of imitating practices of the reference group. Another effect of Sanskritization is that the key characteristics of Dalit culture and society are being eroded. This includes forms of dressing, dance, food, local dialects, etc. For example, the very worth of labor which lower caste do is regarded and rendered as disrespectful. Identities based on the basis of work, art and craft abilities, knowledge, forms of medicine, ecology, agriculture, animal husbandry, etc. are regarded worthless in the industrial era. In general, due to forces of modernization, industrialization, urbanization, the caste system is certainly breaking down and is changing. What kind of changes one can note in the caste system? First is, caste is no longer that rigid in structure. In urban areas, it is difficult to observe the rigid practices associated with caste, such as notion of purity and pollution. Secondly, backward caste movements has also emphasized the role of secular forces in the upliftment of caste. Among the dominant caste, there is no aspiration to rise up in this caste hierarchy, as they already enjoy dominant status in a given region. On the other hand, among the poorest and the most marginalized of the Dalit caste groups, caste identity seems to compensate their marginality in some domains with constitutional provisions. In other words, they have gained some pride and self-confidence, but otherwise remain excluded and discriminated socially. The other important process of change that we will discuss in this chapter is westernization. As compared to Sanskritization as a process of change that pertains to social mobility that existed before the onset of colonialism, westernization arose in a context marked by changes that colonialism brought about in India. This includes direct exposure to modern and Western ideas of freedom, equality, and liberty. Westernization refers to a process of the imitation of Western culture and practices by the non-Western countries. In the Indian context, westernization refers to changes that were brought about in Indian society and culture as a result of the British rule, including changes at the different levels in technology, institutions, ideologies, lifestyles, and values. Some of these changes we have discussed in the previous chapter on the structural changes. There is a general tendency among us to equate westernization with modernization, but both the terms have different meanings. While modernization has a wider connotation, westernization is a sub-process of modernization. Modernization is about rationality and spirit of reasoning, whereas westernization entails the imitation of external forms of culture. It does not necessarily mean that people adopt modern values such as democracy and equality despite being westernized. There are people who are very Western in their clothes and outlook and appearances, but who do not have democratic or egalitarian values that are part of modern attitudes. There are different kinds of westernization. One, it may refer to the emergence of westernized subcultural pattern through a small section of Indians who first came in contact with Western culture. This included the subculture of Indian intellectuals who adopted many patterns or ways of thinking, style of life, and supported its expansion. Example, many of the 19th century social reformers attempted to introduce Western style of education in India. However, this was a small section of society which adopted Western lifestyles and were affected by Western ways of thinking. Apart from this, there has been a general spread of Western cultural traits, and it has become intense in the last few decades with forces of globalization and migration. This includes the use of new technology, gadgets, dressing styles, food habits, lifestyle, English language, and idea of recreational activities. Observe and identify the ways in which westernization has influenced our lives. One small instance is how soft drink has replaced humble lassi as welcome drink in our houses. The traditional sewing and embroidery has been replaced by ready-made pieces. Chocolates have replaced homemade sweets on Diwali and other festivals. There is provision of even sending an e-rakhi to your brother located in any part of the world. According to M.N. Srinivas, while lower caste sought to be Sanskritized, upper caste sought to be westernized. However, we cannot generalize in a complex society like India, which is culturally so diverse. Westernization also often becomes source of conflict between generations. Where the elders value tradition and expect younger generation to follow it, younger generation is getting drawn towards Western lifestyle, culture, values, and music. To conclude, let us summarize what we discussed today. We discussed about process of Sanskritization and its criticism. We also discussed about process of westernization and how it is different from modernization, and how both these processes have resulted in cultural changes in Indian society. In the next part, we'll discuss about process of secularization and globalization. Till then, you can enjoy reading.